If you thought that 2020 couldn't get any more bizarre than it already is, well, think again, because I'm here to tell you that there's something happening up on the moon right now, and yes, I am serious. And that would normally sound crazy, but again, it is 2020. The year so strange that even when the United States Pentagon, for the first time ever, officially released video footage of UFOs being chased by Navy fighter jets, and by the way, while defying the known laws of physics, and nobody cared. And in just the last few days, they straight up declared that those crafts are indeed off-world vehicles not made on Earth. So, aliens? Shouldn't this be, oh, I don't know, all over the news 24/7? Shouldn't this be front page headline news articles everywhere? I mean, it has received some coverage, of course, but nothing at all like most people would have imagined. In fact, most media outlets didn't even cover it at all, and those that did only did so very briefly. And I'll be making an entire video on that, and it turns out that Congress is going to be briefed on that situation, so I look forward to making that video as more details come to light. But that aside, here's a fun question. Isn't it interesting that in the middle of a global pandemic and all the other exciting things happening around the world, that the most powerful countries on Earth are all rushing to send humans to the moon so they can set up moon bases and mine it? For example, President Trump signed an executive order back in May accelerating the process of humans returning to the moon for mining operations, and just like the UFOs, this story received so little attention. And it's not just the United States. In just the last few days, both China and Russia established that they too will be moving forward to set up bases on the moon so they can mine it. And on top of that, they will not be doing so in partnership with the United States as we had apparently wanted. So let's see here. Humans first went to the moon back in July of 1969, and we haven't been back since the Apollo moon missions ended in 1972. But now, all of a sudden, and in the midst of all the exciting things happening around the world, the most powerful countries on Earth are rushing to go to the moon so they can mine the place. Huh. Now hold that thought, because here's another fun question. Out of all the interesting things that you heard about the Apollo moon missions, and out of all the headline news articles that followed, you know, the Eagle has landed, as well as Neil Armstrong's famous words of one small step for a man, one giant leap for mankind, and all the rest of it, do you recall any headline or a statement by NASA or anything at all about the Apollo moon missions that basically discussed that, hey, by the way, it turns out the moon is a giant galactic gold mine, and once our technology advances enough in the future, we are totally going back so we can mine the place and make a fortune? Yeah, no, I definitely missed that memo. I mean, if anything, they made it seem like the moon was basically just a boring dead space rock. You know, nothing interesting to see here. We got some hills, some rocks, and a bunch of dust, and oh, look, a footprint, and yeah, that's about it. But hey, we brought back a bunch of bland-looking moon rocks for y'all to look at, and you know what? None of these rocks here seem to inform me that there is an abundance of rare earth metals on the moon, including elements that which are key components in technology that we use every day, including cell phones, computers, medical equipment, and many other things. And most of these rare earth metals currently are mined in China. But here's the thing. They estimate that they only have 15 to 20 years left before depleting those deposits. And that's not all, as they also know that there's mercury, silver, gold, and platinum on the moon as well. Hence the urgency to get up there and mine the place. And by the way, it's also worth mentioning that we know that there is an abundance of water ice on the moon, which the hydrogen and oxygen can be separated in order to produce rocket fuel, which will then be used to launch crafts on other missions, including trips to Mars, straight from the moon, which has many logistic benefits when compared to the stresses of such launches within Earth's gravity. Now, all of that is very interesting and makes sense, but what conversation has there been, aside from just the last few years, about the fact that there is a fortune waiting to be dug up on the moon? A fortune so massive that it's worth the risk of spaceflight and landing on the moon, not to mention the insane cost to make it all happen. I mean, they're calling it the Space Gold Rush, and the most powerful countries on Earth are now rushing to make it happen. So let's be real. Some people are going to make an intergalactic fortune from that place, and something tells me that it's not going to be me that sees any of that money. Nope, not likely at all. And you know what? That right there is why I think it never was a front page headline in the newspapers. I mean, scientists have acknowledged the desire to mine the moon for various elements. They've been saying it for years, but you know, so it's not some secret. But make no mistake, a vast overwhelming percentage of the general public has no idea, and I find that interesting. Now, before I move on to something even more interesting than that, let me share something else about moon rocks. Fun fact, there are currently at least 184 missing moon rocks that were apparently sold on the black market by those who received them as gifts from the various moon missions when they were brought back here to Earth. Take this BBC article from back in 2012 that explains it, and get this. It's known that these rocks have been sold for as much as $5 million in the past, so there you go. Yeah, I'm not gonna lie. If I could afford one, I'd buy one too. I mean, what a cool thing to have. And by the way, how much fun would it be to bring that thing to parties, right? Show that off, it'd be a great conversation piece. You know, hey, you wanna check out my moon rock? It comes from outer space and everything. Now, let me get back on track here, as this is where things get even more interesting. So, do you want to hear a headline about the moon that you certainly never heard about? Because, well, it never was a headline at all whatsoever. And actually, I don't even know what to start with this, as it's so bizarre, but here we go. Apollo 11 astronauts saw a green fluorescent light on the surface of the moon before they landed on it for the first time ever. That's right, I'll say it again. Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, and Michael Collins are on board Apollo 11 and quickly approaching the moon, a matter of hours from preparing to land on the moon for the first time ever, when they receive a radio call from NASA stating that astronomers in Germany could currently see a green fluorescent light near the Aristarchus crater on the surface of the moon, which these images, by the way, right here are of that specific crater, but not this incident. But Michael Collins immediately responded to the call from NASA, which, by the way, indicates that either they were already looking at it or it was so noticeable that they spotted it immediately upon looking out the window. And this light lasted between 1 and 2 minutes, a bright greenish fluorescent light. This really happened, and there's even a name for it, transient lunar phenomena. And of course, so few people are aware of this, but it's certainly not a secret. In fact, you can read about it on NASA.gov, and there's been multiple scientific studies published on it in scientific journals going back decades. The Society for Popular Astronomy has information on it, and there was even an interesting article about it on Live Science just last year. Hell, you can even go to NASA Technical Report Server and read an extensive paper on nearly 1,500 examples of the phenomena of moonlights going back, get this, nearly 1,500 years. In fact, there have been at least 2,000 worldwide reports spanning all the way back to the year 554 AD to present. Now, many of these examples are flashes of white light, which are undoubtedly caused by meteorite impacts, but then there are numerous incidences of lights that were described as reddish or pinkish in color, and sometimes observed in a sparkling or flowing-like appearance. And other colors seen include white, green, and violet. And this right here is the first photo ever taken of transient lunar phenomena. It was taken back in November of 1953 from a telescope here on Earth, and by the way, this is straight from Columbia University's website. This is a real photo, and moonlights are a real thing, yet so few people have ever heard of it. Now, there are some other pictures and videos you can find on the internet documented by amateur astronomers. However, in this day and age, it's hard to ever say what's real and what's fake. So let me just say that this photo here is completely verified, but if it wasn't from a credible source, wouldn't you think it's fake? I mean, I probably would, especially if I had never heard of moonlights before. So, going back to the 2-minute long fluorescent green light seen by the Apollo 11 astronauts, well, that sure doesn't sound like some sort of meteorite impact, because it's one thing to have a bunch of documented cases of flashing white light, right? Meteorite impacts, it's not hard to think that, but when you have sustained lighting of different colors, this raises questions, especially when you consider the fact that this happened just hours before landing on the moon for the first time ever. Like, what timing is that for something that's so rare, something that's so few people know about, and the fact that it was never even a headline. I mean, just think, out of all those headlines you saw, you know, the Eagle has landed, but lights seen on the moon was not. Now, there are a few different hypotheses of what this moonlight phenomena could be, including escaping gas from the interior of the moon due to seismic activity, and then in combination of dust from the lunar surface and the electrostatic charging from solar wind. Another hypothesis could be that it's volcanic activity. And all of this sounds reasonable to me. I don't disagree. I mean, I'm not suggesting that it's, you know, alien moon bases flashing spotlights back at us, but maybe. Here's the thing. If any of these hypotheses are true, wouldn't it mean that the moon isn't just some dead, boring space rock like we've been led to believe? I mean, especially if there's evidence of volcanic activity in recent times. I mean, according to scientists, the moon was once volcanically active. Even the so-called face on the moon is the result of ancient lava flows. However, this was said to be many, many millions of years ago. Even take these examples where they say, oh, this here was 58 million years ago, and this lava field over here was 33 million years ago, and oh, hey, look, this one is 18 million years old. You know, I'd really like to know how they came to those specific time frames, because even just 1 million years is a very long period of time. So how do they differentiate between the millions of years? For example, I'd like for them to explain why it was 18 million years ago and not 16 or 20 million years ago. See what I'm saying? See, this is where things get more interesting, because there have been eyewitness accounts documented by credible astronomers detailing how they saw volcanoes on the moon. An interesting example was during the night of April 19th, 1787, by notable British astronomer Sir William Herschel, who observed three red glowing spots on a dark part of the moon. Herschel attributed this phenomena to erupting volcanoes. And just 3 years later, he saw something else, which was what appeared to be a star-like appearance on the shadowed part of the moon. And 4 years after that, other reports circulated that a volcano could be seen on the moon with the naked eye. And there are many other similar examples that go back more than 1,000 years. But when something is so long ago, it does leave room for doubt and debate and skepticism. However, there are credible reports within just the last several decades. For example, on May 20th, 1948, British astronomer Richard Baum noted a reddish glow to the northeast part of the Fallows crater, which he watched for 15 minutes before it faded from sight. And then 3 years later, he observed another red glow west of the Lichtenberg crater. And guys, this is credible. In fact, let me give you another example. On November 2nd, 1958, Russian astronomer Nikolai Kozrev observed an apparent half-hour-long eruption that took place on the central peak of the Alphonsus crater while using a 48-inch reflector telescope. That does not meet the description of what would be a flash from a meteorite impact. I mean, come on, sustained glowing red light, which they even described as appearing to be an eruption? That sure sounds like volcanic activity to me, and none of this was millions of years ago. This is recent, and it raises many questions, and some of these sightings have even lasted hours on end. On November 15, 1965, personnel of the Trident Engineering Associates Incorporation out of Annapolis, Maryland, observed a color phenomenon which lasted at least 4 hours. 4 hours, I wonder what that's about. And let me just mention real quick, a couple of these screenshots are from Wikipedia, but always check their sources, you know, if they check out. Guys, this just makes the presentation a little bit easier. Like I said earlier, you can read about all of these things on NASA.gov. There's been multiple scientific studies published within journals going back a few decades. You can even go to the NASA Technical Report server and read an extensive paper on nearly 1,500 examples of this phenomena going back 1.5 millennia, like I mentioned earlier. So I never recommend Wikipedia, but in this case, they share several dozen examples that can be verified from various sources. And I do like that they included this animation here, which illustrates the prior work done by two notable astronomers that depicts some 300 examples of transient lunar phenomena in specific locations that they were seen on the moon. And the red dots signify sightings that were reddish or pinkish in color, and the yellow dots signify all other colors. Leave a comment if you've never heard of this before. I mean, I know some people have, because of course there's people that look into my channel or into all kinds of cool topics, but this is not common knowledge at all. I mean, we've all looked at the moon countless times throughout our lives, but I've never seen a light on it. And if I did, like if I saw a red sparkling light on the moon for minutes or hours on end, that in itself would be jaw-dropping. And again, there are thousands of reported cases. Imagine how many have happened while no one was watching or was never reported. Just imagine if more people had telescopes, and I recommend that everyone should buy one. So, that all said, everybody knows Neil Armstrong's one small step for a man quote. We all got that memo. But I'd bet that 99 out of 100 people walking down the street have never heard of moonlights before. They don't know what transient lunar phenomena is. I mean, go up to some random person and be like, hey, did you know that Neil Armstrong saw a fluorescent light on the surface of the moon? They'd probably laugh at you. Or actually, they might not laugh at you. They'd think that you're nuts, so they wouldn't laugh. They'd be afraid of you. But then again, it is 2020, the year when facts make people upset. But the truth is that the more you look into the moon, the more interesting it becomes. Listen to this. There are many miles of lava tubes throughout the surface and subsurface of the moon. Giant caves created by past lava flows, which, by the way, are even being suggested as possible places to set up moon bases. And some of these caves are massive. For example, this one here connects to a 30-mile-long tunnel under the moon's surface. And the chasm you see here is some 300 feet wide and drops some 100 meters below the moon's surface. Well, that's fascinating. Why don't we hurry up and go there with, I don't know, a GoPro and a flashlight and some rope and drop it on down there so we can see what it looks like. I want to see what's down there and I want to see it in 4K. You know, it's things like these lava tubes that make me wonder why we haven't been back to the moon sooner. I mean, because here they are, they're planning on going back and setting up habitats on the moon and in within these caves, but without ever exploring them first. Think about that. The Apollo astronauts did not go into any caves, yet here they are planning on building a nuclear power plant within one. I'm sorry, am I the only one that gets this feeling that maybe, just maybe, certain people on Earth know more details about the moon than maybe the general public? I mean, a lot of these things aren't secret, but it's not common knowledge, and with this sudden rush to go back and mine the place, well, consider this. Another thing most people don't realize is that China has had a mysterious rover on the so-called dark side of the moon for about a year and a half now, and who knows what they're doing up there. I mean, you can read about various experiments they're conducting, including growing plants and insects, which, okay, I already have 100 questions about that. But they've even released some information on their studies, including that they have found a weird substance on the moon. But, oh look, another out-of-focus picture that looks like it was taken with my old flip phone. And let me also point out that you'll notice that the so-called dark side of the moon is not actually dark. In fact, it receives just as much sunlight as the side that we see all the time. It's just due to the fact that the moon is tidal locked, it never fully rotates, thus leaving 41% of the far side of the moon always out of our view. And you can see the comparison of what each side looks like. But again, look at these grainy photos. Does this look like 4K Ultra HD to you? I mean, come on. How is this 2018 technology? Because that's when they got there. I mean, my camera right in front of me, and this is a cloth tapestry, by the way. This is a wall. It's not freaking green screen. This is higher quality than some of these pictures that are taken. Like, come on. You know what? I demand that the next time we go to the moon on a rover or whatever, or go to Mars with another rover, or we fly a satellite past some planet, I demand that they put the latest version of an iPhone up there to go along with whatever of these other cameras they're always using, and just take some as-is photos for me with an iPhone, which takes good photos. I just want to see it like that. Am I the only one feeling that way? But anyways, complaints aside, who knows what China is up to on the far side of the moon, and maybe this headline sums it up perfectly, but as far as us sending back people to the moon, and that's thanks to Trump's executive order, Congress, for whatever reason, chose not to provide the necessary funding requested by NASA in order to send humans back to the moon by 2024. NASA needs $5 billion, and Congress decided to only give $1.25 billion. NASA is hoping that this will change, but as of today, going back to the moon in 2024 is now on the rocks. Are you kidding me? You know, I made a video on this 2 years ago after they did the same thing. They canceled another mission going back to the moon that was supposed to get back there and in 2020. That's right now, we're supposed to be there with humans on the moon, But here we are again for like the 100th time, pushing back sending humans to the moon again. This is getting ridiculous, and for more than one reason. And another issue is that a lot of people, many people, doubt that we ever went to the moon in the first place. Now, me personally, I think we went, but that's not what this video is about at all. And you can look up images that they have from satellites that have taken pictures of our landing sites and tracks that were left there by the astronauts. So that said, if Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin didn't go, well, somebody has sure been back since. And the fact that certain people want to go back and invest so much money to go mine the moon, guys, nobody goes to someplace cosmic to mine something and invest all that money unless they know what's there. Unless they know they're going to make a fortune on their investment. So, guys, somebody's been there. You want a conspiracy? The moon is basically a giant cosmic gold mine, and they're going to use your taxpayer money to go there, and somebody's going to make a fortune on it, and it won't be you. There you go. That's it. And meanwhile, there's this huge push to send humans to Mars, which I think is outstanding. I'm all for it. But it's starting to sound like we'll be landing on Mars before we ever get back to the moon, the way they keep canceling it, which of course makes no sense to me. Hey, you guys want to know something? We've already been to Mars. They sent me. I went to Mars. I was the first one there ever. And I know you're thinking, oh, you don't believe me? Well, I got pics for proof. You want to see? Boom. Here you go. I swear that this is unedited. It's a non-rendered photo taken with a cheap digital camera back in April of 2010. Yep. That's me, and as you can see, this is obviously Mars, and yeah, it was a military operation, as you can see from the t-shirt. I'm not allowed to talk about it. It's classified, and so there you go. Sorry, Elon. I went there first. Get over it. I'm obviously having fun here. I mean, come on. I'm wearing an outer space shirt here, so this is fun. But let me just say that people can debate the reasons why there's a desire to go mine the moon or come up with whatever scientific explanation for what the moonlight phenomena is. But the reality is that the moon is full of unanswered questions. There are some great hypotheses out there, but there's a lot of things that are not certain. And it's time we go back so we can all have something fun and positive to look at and discuss. I mean, just consider how excited people were about SpaceX launching humans back in space recently. And yes, they partnered with NASA astronauts, but the fact is that Elon Musk and thousands of other brilliant SpaceX employees made this happen when others didn't. It's inspiring, and it's exactly what humanity needs in these dark times when the future is so uncertain. And speaking of moon mysteries, I do have some questions about where the moon came from and when. And again, you know, this is just fun conversation. It's conjecture. Don't be quoting me on what I'm about to say, okay? Just pretend that we're, I don't know, having drinks at a bar and shooting the crap on the mysteries of the universe. But I, you know, obviously I study the ancients, if you're familiar with my channel, and there is a tribe in Africa called the Dogon people that have legends that have been passed down for thousands of years claiming that there was a time before the moon. That may or may not be true, but many people, us, you know, crazy, insane conspiracy theorists who should be medicated, wonder if the moon was brought here a long time ago and geoengineered to be just the right size and just the right density to facilitate an abundance of life here on Earth. Now, hold on. I'm not certain of this. Again, this is fun conversation. I'm not telling you to believe this, okay? Y'all bear with me. It's an idea. And honestly, I wonder if it's possible. In fact, I would say that it's far more possible than most people even want to acknowledge or believe. But let me also say that there are countless trillions of stars and planets, and with all the chaos in the universe, it's totally possible that amazing coincidences happen by just sheer odds, of course, and perhaps we just got lucky. But I think that it is just as likely as one or the other, regardless of how crazy it may sound. So when people say that the moon was brought here and geoengineered and claim that the moon was hollowed out to achieve just the right density, might sound crazy, but keep in mind, the moon's unusual density is still a mystery. For example, NASA deliberately crashed launch vehicles into the moon during Apollo missions, and then the seismographs that were set up there during the missions registered some very unusual and surprising results. In one case, the seismographs bounced back and forth for 60 minutes, and another time for 3.5 hours. And because of that, some have suggested that the moon may have some type of cavity or hollow interior of some kind. as following the seismic results, the scientists described it as having an unusually long seismic reverberation as if ringing like a bell. And don't confuse that as if it sounded like a bell, but rather the fact that the seismic reverberations lasted hours on end, bouncing back and forth just like a bell does when it rings. So let me just say real quick, scientists do not think that the moon is hollow at all, okay? You can read up all about it. It's just, the thing that's interesting about the moon is that they claim to know what the interior of the moon looks like. Like, take this image, this is from NASA. But they've only drilled 9.5 feet or 3 meters into the moon. In fact, you can see a picture of it happening right here. So let's be real, nobody knows what the interior of the moon looks like or consists of exactly. And hence, you know what, this is another reason to go back, because they should drill another hole much deeper and send a camera down there so we all take a peek at what it looks like. But that aside, let me point some other interesting things out about the moon that most people don't appreciate is just how much it influences life on Earth as we know it. Our oceans, weather, the four seasons, and the hours and minutes of our days, without the moon, the tides would fall, nights would be darker, seasons would change, and the length of our days would alter down to possibly 6 to 12 hours in a day. And because of that, there would be more than 1,000 days in 1 year. That's because the Earth's rotation slows down over time thanks to the gravitational force or pull of the moon. And without it, ocean tides would be greatly reduced, which would be terrible because they are responsible for the majority of ocean life as we know it. Most ocean life lives within tidal zones. And not to mention all the various animal life on Earth and in the ocean, and even including insects and everything else that depend on moonlight in order to survive. Here's something else that's thought-provoking, which involves the precise size of the moon in comparison with the sun and how it mirrors our use of time on Earth. Consider this. The sun is approximately 864,000 miles in diameter, and a full day on Earth has 86,400 seconds. Ignore the zeros for a moment and just look at that 864 number being the same. Then consider the radius of the sun, which of course is half the diameter, so 432,000 miles. And compare that to half a day on Earth, which is 43,200 seconds. Again, ignore the zeros, and the 432 number is the same. Well, the number 432 is interesting because it's been seen in abundance among ancient civilizations. And it's not understood why. And Randall Carlson, who I highly recommend you look into, gives a fascinating argument that suggests that whoever built the Great Pyramid of Giza may have had advanced knowledge on the size of the Earth, which is inexplicable. Definitely check out his work, but consider this. The number 108 is another number that's seen in ancient times, which also is unexplained. And when you divide the distance of the sun and the moon by their distances from the Earth, they both equate to 108. Now, that could just be a number. We don't have to get caught up on that. But the precise size and distances of the moon and the sun compared to what we see here on Earth provide us with our spectacular solar eclipses, which are just the right size. Either all of this is a coincidence, which it certainly could be, or it could be indicative of intelligence. Again, you know, maybe all of this means nothing, or perhaps it means everything. What I do know is that the physics of all of it worked out in such a way that provided an abundance of life to flourish here on Earth, something that we should all be very grateful for, as most people are not aware of just how much the moon has done for us. Fun stuff, right? Again, guys, I don't pretend to have all the answers. I'm not trying to convince you. I'm sure some people are like, oh my God, well, he's just rambling these numbers, these crazy conspiracy theories. Like, guys, anything's possible. And something about the moon, there's just too many things that add up that to me, maybe it's just a gut feeling, which, hey, you can throw that out, throw it in the trash. It doesn't mean anything to a lot of people, but I just kind of get this feeling that there's more to the story. And I find it odd about this delaying to go back. Well, meanwhile, these missions happening that people aren't aware of. I just feel like there's more to the story. And of course, there's so much we don't know. And so why not just go back so we can all find out the answers together instead of relying on a lot of hypotheses? So definitely leave a comment on your thoughts about all the things I discuss in this video, whether it's the UFO topic, which I can't wait to make that video. And also share your thoughts on this desire to go hurry up and mine the moon, as well as this moonlight phenomena. I mean, is the moon still active? Because again, I'm not saying that it's some alien base flashing lights at us. Or again, who knows? Because apparently aliens are here already. Got crafts defying the laws of physics. Nobody cares. So don't act like we know everything that's happening on the moon. I guess that's my point. And if there's one point I want to make about the entire video is that we don't know enough. There's enough mystery and we should go back and find out, all right? So with that said, I'll wrap this up. But hit the like button, subscribe if you aren't subscribed to me already, and also follow me on Instagram. I'm going to be taking that up a level and sharing more things about me personally, as well as more updates on this channel. So follow me on Instagram, because there's going to be things on there that won't be on here. Anyways, guys, I'll leave it at that. Hit the like button, subscribe, leave a comment, share your thoughts. Much love to everyone. See you all again soon. Take care.